So summarizing what has been done through the day and maybe yesterday also will be quite a task because of the sheer diversity and the number of topics that we've touched on during the questions and during the talks by various panelists. What I'm doing now is harking back to two of the three challenges I was asked about yesterday by Anita Anand for women in an ICT media context. So one of the things I spoke about was access. Now today, the journalists from Khabar Lehriya mentioned that because they use predominantly Indian languages, and that too, these are among the smaller languages. Hindi, Tamil have far more content, and in terms of sheer number of native speakers also, they have more people speaking these languages. So the languages that they deal in, Awadhi, Hindustani, they have their own unique challenges looking for content on the web, creating content on the web. So in terms of Indian languages, now if the content is in Unicode, And everyone uses standard ASCII hardware. So if by that I mean there's a standard for hardware so that devices all over the world are compatible irrespective of the different components you use. So it's only in the Unicode font that a search engine bot, which is can trawl through the content, can index the content, which makes it searchable on the web. If it's some other font, it will just look gibberish to the bot, and it will not be able to figure out what's actually written on the web page, which is why it will not then index it and show it in its search results. So it is the crawlability of the page, and it could not be the font, it could be anything. A lot of government websites which are in Indian languages are not in Unicode fonts, and there are some fancy fonts which you can't really find among a standard typeface or a font set, which makes it difficult for so that government website does not show up in search results at all. Or it will just show up as something gibberish which you will not explore. So that is one challenge. If it's not searchable, it's as good as it doesn't exist on the web. It's not discoverable because most people will try and look for it. There are very few people who will actually know the URL and visit it directly. The other challenge, of course, is the human challenge, lack of skills to use it, and searching in Indian languages, creating the content and using the content and accessing the content is a different ball game, because the whole dynamic changes. So, if you know a certain search string that you construct in English that you know will get you a certain kind of result just by practice, by just using Google or some other search engine, you would know that if you can exclude certain keywords, you can include certain keywords. That thing changes when you search in Indian languages. And of course, there is the problem that there is the amount of content in Indian languages is much less. And when I mean Indian languages, we are talking about countless languages. And there are Wikipedias in 24 Indian languages, and around 18 or 20 more are in incubation, which means they are now being developed. And for languages like, Go and Konkani, which don't have a defined script, so that Wikipedia is actually coming up in three scripts where there is the Roman script, there is Devanagari, and there's one more, I'm not sure, but it's the Tulu Kannada script, yeah. So, but then Wikipedias are searchable because they all come with searchable web page structures and searchable fonts. With respect to the tech architecture panel that we had today, how would you tie in gender with tech architectures of the internet? How would you tie in gender with internet governance? So one is going back to the security challenge that I mentioned, that of course women use the internet as a space for organization, for self-expression, as sometimes as a safe haven to express things they wouldn't express online, especially in traditional or repressive societies. We're talking about sex and sexuality is taboo, so on and so forth. So one aspect is security, that tech architectures should not be fundamentally flawed in such a way that they'll thwart security, that women should have their privacy and security and should be able to exercise agency. And this is where the role of feminist techies come in. And when I say feminist techies, I don't essentially mean female techies. It's people with a gender-sensitive feminist outlook who understand the challenges that the web throws at you at the tech architecture level, and not, and I don't mean just the end user level, but at the tech architecture level. The other aspect is that the web should be free and open. Suman Roy spoke about free software today, and someone said free of cost or almost free of cost. So there are two different concepts of free when it comes to software or when we speak about the free and open movement. So free as in muft, or free as in mukt. So here I mean free as in freedom. And the tech architecture should ensure that internet remains a free and open space for women to express themselves. To I've seen an interesting trend of women monetizing their blogs and websites, and now there's this trend that many women entrepreneurs are coming up that they only have e-shops. So they'll sell jewelry, handmade jewelry, handicrafts, clothes online that they make at home or in a small setup at home, and they sell it. And this is a source of income for them. And this is it's not entirely new, but I'm seeing a boost in the number of these kind of women, because setting up e-commerce shops, and not, I mean the small e-stores and not big sites like Flipkart, is becoming easier for them. Processing payments and other things are becoming easier for them. Then in terms of internet governance, it's gender sometimes gets left out or most of the time is the thing that is treated last and gets left out of the conversations around technology or around internet governance or anything that is on the intersection of technical structures. And gender is something that, in fact, I would stick out a leg and say complicates the discussion the most. So when we speak of tech architectures, we should also speak about gender inclusion. And the last point is, of course, obvious, that women have to be proactively participating, and that participation should be proactively encouraged in technical communities, in making decisions around the web structures, web architectures, in the decision making processes. The voice should definitely be there. And coming back to the last discussion on data, where I thought, you know, the gender angle was really somewhere in the undercurrents and wasn't coming out. And there was, in the question answer round, there was quite a lot of discussion on how clean is the data, how accurate is the data, who collects the data, who considers the data valid, crowdsource data, NGOs collect data, governments collect data, census data, you know, what is public, how much of the data is public, how much of it has personally identifiable information. So this is a vast area. I don't really want to go into it, it'll take a lot more time and discussion to be able to deal with the conflicts and nuances of all these topics. But once the relevance of data and to the gender debate that we're having here is, once you've got data, and let us for all practical purposes assume that it is accurate data and it's acceptable and it will be considered valid, it is to ultimately be able to use that data, to make that data actionable. There are various ways to use it from a gendered lens. And my favorite example is that of crowd maps, where Harris Map Egypt or there's a Harris Map Mumbai also, if anyone has heard of it. So that's crowdsourced information. It's not necessarily data, but it's more of visualization and mapping, but that is a form of crowdsourced data. And how does this data, in whatever form you get it, how does this help you from a gendered perspective? So it's, and the GIS people can come in here. So it's how would the mapping of the streets, how would the number of street lanes and how would their positioning affect the rate of crime? How is that linked to a certain type of crime or a certain type of gender violence? Can you actually predict or can you draw up a probability of how the number of alleys in this part of the city will invite this kind of a crime? This is what that data and GIS analysis will actually help you with. So once we are past those barriers of collection, how do you collect, whether it's authentic, it is this that you really need to use it for. How is the presence or absence or number of street lamps affecting the rate of crimes? And it's a very well-established fact that the biggest deterrent to crime is a very simple thing. It's the street lamp. And the sort of urban planning initiatives that Satyarupa displayed today, how do you make, you know, women, you can use them to make women visible or invisible. How would you go ahead and do that? So it's not always that women being visible or invisible is a good or a bad thing. In certain types of data, it is important to bring out women, because in topics like urban development or urban planning, women are more often than not invisible. Or hypothetically, there can be a situation where someone wants to find out who are the homosexuals in this room, but they will not go to the homosexuals. They'll ask you, they'll ask, please, all heterosexuals come here, and they don't have a problem with declaring that they are heterosexual. So obviously everyone who's left is queer. So they don't even need to come to you and ask you for your data or your personal information. By sheer exclusion, they'll know. They'll get certain sensitive data, and which is why we need data protection policies, and we need criminalization of the collection of personal data without any reason. And because the concept of privacy is alien to us, it's getting all the more complicated. But the point I was trying to make is this kind of data mapping and data gathering will actually make women visible where they don't really have a voice or a presence or a testimony.